There are two main actors in this video. On the one hand, we have topological quantum field theories motivated by physics. On the other hand, we have the world of abstract algebra, and in particular, Frobenius algebras. What we will see is that these two are related to each other. When I first learned about this, I was baffled. These things seem to be completely unrelated at first sight, and yet, in some sense, they are just the same thing. For me, this is a very good example of the beauty of mathematics. Two seemingly different areas of mathematics connected through abstract thinking. At the beginning of the 20th century, two big revolutions happened in physics. General relativity gave a completely new description of gravity. The natural language for gravity turned out to be the mathematics of manifolds and curvature. On the other hand, quantum mechanics gave a new way of looking at fundamental particles. Particles are in a superposition of different states, and we can only determine the exact state through measurement. These states are modeled mathematically in the language of complex numbers and Hilbert spaces. Frustratingly, the two theories clash. General relativity still adopts a classical view of other forces than gravity, while quantum mechanics assumes flat spacetime. The theory breaks down near massive objects like black holes. Physicists hope to unify these two theories in the description of gravity according to the principles of quantum mechanics, quantum gravity. In the search for quantum gravity, physicists have come up with toy models, simplified models of reality from which they hope to gain valuable insights. One such class of toy models are the so-called topological quantum field theories, or TQFTs for short. We will view space as some compact manifold without boundary. In principle, this should be three-dimensional to model the world we know. This makes the theory a lot more difficult, so we will instead consider one-dimensional manifolds, as these are much simpler to work with. Indeed, one can always smoothly transform a one-dimensional manifold to a circle, or multiple copies of a circle. This gives us a description of space. Now we need to incorporate quantum theory. For this, we need a Hilbert space, which is the mathematical object used to describe the possible states of a quantum system. If we have multiple circles, then the resulting Hilbert space should contain all the possible ways to combine the states from the different circles. The mathematical way to do this is through the tensor product. So far, this really doesn't look that interesting. However, we still have one final ingredient to consider: time. Throughout time, the shape of space might change. Looking at the shape traced out by such a transformation, we get a two-dimensional manifold, whose boundaries correspond to space before and after the transformation. We call such shapes cobordisms. We only care about the topological shape of these cobordisms. This means that we can stretch or squish the shape as if it were rubber. This is where the topological in topological quantum field theory comes from. So, for example, these two cobordisms, which look different at first sight, are really the same. Mathematicians have come up with a brilliant name for this shape. They call it a pair of pants. Now, because the shape of space can change throughout time, so can the associated Hilbert spaces. Hence, we need to associate to each cobordism a transformation of Hilbert spaces. Crucially, this association should be compatible with the way we can combine cobordisms. Let me explain what I mean with an example. These two cobordisms are the same. Indeed, it is common knowledge that gluing a pair of pants to the pant leg of another pair of pants yields pants with three legs. Let us call the maps associated to the merging of two or three circles, M2 and M3 respectively. Then we get the following equation. The map ID is the identity map, a mathematical way of saying it leaves its input unchanged. What we just saw is that we can make the map M3 out of M2. This leads to the important observation that we really only need to consider these four cobordisms. Any other cobordism can be built out of just these four. For example, this one can be decomposed as follows. Since these are the building blocks of all cobordisms, we should study their associated maps more closely. We have the following cobordism, which starts out from nothing and creates a circle. To what Hilbert space should nothing correspond? Let us call it K. We know that two circles correspond to the tensor product of the Hilbert space with itself. On the other hand, if we have a single circle, You can also view it as a circle together with nothing. So, the tensor product of h with k should just be h itself. Intuitively, this is because k represents a system with only one possible state. So, since it's already predetermined, it doesn't offer any new states when combining it with h. The Hilbert space with one state is C, the complex numbers. This means we have four maps, which we call multiplication, co-multiplication, unit and co-unit respectively. Why does it make sense to call it multiplication, and what does co-multiplication even mean? Let us start with the thing that sounds familiar to us, multiplication. We all know that 2 times 3 is 6, but what does that have to do with this? At the first step, we will write xy for the result of multiplying x and y via mu. What we now need to show is that this behaves as we are used to. For example, we know that 2 times 3 times 4 is the same as 2 times 3 times 4. So, is x times y times z the same as x times y times z? For this, we just need to look at the relevant cobordisms. First multiplying x and y, and then multiplying the result with z, corresponds to the cobordism on the left. Multiplying y and z first, and then multiplying x by the result of this, corresponds to the cobordism on the right. Since the two cobordisms are the same, the resulting output must be the same as well. In the same vein, we can show that x times y is equal to y times x. Indeed, these two cobordisms are the same. Finally, you may remember that 1 times anything is that thing itself. But what is 1 in this context? This is where the unit comes in. Let us write 1h for the image of the complex number 1 under eta. Then we have that x times 1h is indeed just x. So the name unit is justified. The other two maps, the co-multiplication and co-unit, satisfy the same identities, except that all the maps go the other way around. This is what the co-prefix indicates. There's one final identity to consider. This is what happens when we combine multiplication with co-multiplication. We have three equivalent cobordisms. These are known as the so-called Frobenius conditions. What we have just shown is that H is what mathematicians call a commutative Frobenius algebra. In other words, the study of two-dimensional TQFTs is the same as the study of commutative Frobenius algebras.